I think what we're seeing here out of Rebecca Crockett's deck is going to be kind of common, where the players playing mono red Eldrazi choose to dabble in the white cards because it's almost a free splash.
Yeah, that's kind of the nice thing. You know, you're getting a card like Battlefield Forge, which is going to provide colorless mana. And then, you know, the white splash here, I see Declaration in Stone. Not too much other things, though. Oh, the Displacer as well.
Yep, and some sideboard cards.
Looks like Rebecca is going to be taking a mulligan here.
So, yeah, like you said, between Battlefield Forge and the Needle Spires, the red and white cards mesh nicely into these mono Eldrazi decks.
And it looks like Emma is going to start things off here in round number two, technically our first round, with a port. That'll give him white-blue mana. And now the younger version of Gideon.
Little Kithian.
Yes, Kithian will start things off. Declaration of Stone is going to take care of that. It'll be exiled. A clue is on the way. And round number two is underway here in Baltimore, as we'll head back over to Emma.
So you see Rebecca with some of the more expensive cards in her hand. The Kithian isn't the most potent threat. She's probably not super scared of it, but she knows if she draws one or two lands, she's going to have all of her mana tied up every turn over the next couple of turns.
It's a Council's Lieutenant and a passing of the turn over to Crockett. Westvale Abbey the draw. I think we're going to see a lot of that one this weekend.
That's a potent card.
Yeah, that's a Magic card right there. I had that one at the old pre-release. Pretty tough to beat.
Did we flip that bad boy?
We did flip it a couple of times. A Thopter Engineer is going to bring along a Thopter with it. That's a 1-1 flying artifact. That'll have haste because of the Thopter Engineer. And in for one comes Crockett. Handy's going to fall down to 19.
It attacks. It blocks. What's not to love?
I love all parts of it. We're going to head over to Handy. It'll be her third turn of the game.
And we'll see if her humans deck can start to get onto the board here. It's important for these lower decks to really come out ahead because they can't compete with the high-end coming out of some of the other decks. Once Chandra's start coming down on the board, once big hangerback walkers start coming down, you know, reality smashers, they need to be ahead.
Yeah, Handy's got to be the aggressor in this matchup. No two ways about it. Land number three is a Plains. Now let's see what the play is going to be. It's going to be a Reflector Mage. It's going to take care of the Thopter Engineer to allow an attack here with the Council's Lieutenant. Reflector Mage, another one of those powerful cards. You know, an older one, not one from Shadows, but still very powerful.
It's super efficient. It's everything you want out of a card. It's a threat. It controls the board state, allows you to keep beating in. It beats in itself. Well, you know, does it all.
There are no rally shenanigans with it anymore, thankfully. But that's a heck of a Magic card. This one is two in Pia and Kirin Nalar. That's going to be more Thopters along with it. And you can see with Rebecca's deck, colorless mana not going to be much of an issue. You got Westville Abbey, you've got Shivan Reef, Battlefield Forge. You know, casting Eldrazi does not appear to be very difficult.
It should run smooth most games.
We'll head back Handy's way. She will draw a card. Picked up another Plains for the turn. But as you mentioned, the inability to really get off to too aggressive of a start here. There will be some attacks here. Crockett will take a look at Council's Lieutenant. We'll do the same. Get an idea of what that card does. I think everyone's very familiar with Reflector Mage, of course, because it's Reflector Mage.
Yeah. It's been on camera a few times.
It's seen a little bit of play. Council's Lieutenant, not as much, as here is a Knight of the White Orchid. That's going to search for Plains here. Potentially a Prairie Stream as well. There is the Prairie Stream. Now, one of the nice things about these white-blue human decks, and you also find this with the green version as well, the splashing is actually just not very difficult to do at all.
It very convenient right now. We've got the Battlelands and the Shadowlands.
Evolving Wilds, if you want to do that, you probably don't need to do that, as now there's a Thraven Inspector.
More clues.
Yep. So there are some cards to be drawn here for Emma Handy.
Emma's getting closer to figuring things out.
That's the first of many clue puns.
Oh, the clues.
Yeah. I should have known. There's the Council's Lieutenant. 2-1 First Striker. When it attacks, if it's renowned, which it was not on that attack, other attacking creatures you control get +1/+1 on a turn, and then renown 1. So, have not seen a lot of renown in Constructed, but Council's Lieutenant, I think, is probably going to be a mainstay in these decks, given, you know, good power-toughness ratio for 2 mana. First Striker is relevant, and of course, it's a human.
Yep, very, very solid stats. And then, like you said, it's a human, so it's going to interact well with some of the human cards, Thalia's Lieutenant, and cards like that.
A Thopter Engineer here for Crockett. She can play that again.
These Thopters are starting to get out of control.
So one of the weaknesses to this humans deck is flying. naturally, humans are going to be on the ground for the most part. So these Thopters that are going to have haste and then Pian, Kira, and Alar can throw them at Emma Handy, they're going to be an issue.
But if we see Emma draw a Declaration in Stone, no more Thopter tokens anymore, yeah, and no clues. Also, if Emma peels Always Watching, all of these little guys are very potent threats all of a sudden.
Emma's going to start by sacrificing a clue. One card you may not have realized she played last turn was a copy of Dragon Hunter. So do keep in mind that's out there. Very nice card against Thunderbreak Regent, which is still legal. The follow-up here is sacrificing another clue, so more cards for Emma Handy. But just a couple of lands drawn, so nothing too exciting for her right now.
Yeah, but I think she's still in a position where she can still crack in. The Lieutenant's going to make her team big enough. She's got a couple of first strikers, and she has to be worried about the Flyers on the other side. So I think it behooves her to stay aggressive.
Well, with Rebecca not attacking last turn with any of those Thopters, again, remember those Thopters all have haste. Some of them were out there prior from the Pian, Kira, and Alar. It leads me to believe that Crockett is trying to play a little bit more of a defensive game. So if I'm Emma, I've got some interest in probably attacking, and it appears that she does.
Yep.
So just about everybody coming in here. Yeah, it looks like everyone's going to come into the red zone.
I like this. Getting frisky.
Yep. Council's Lieutenant. Going to make these creatures a little bit larger. Again, whenever it attacks, if it's renowned, which it is, other attacking creatures you control get +1/+1 until end of turn.
Yeah, we didn't put these cards in our deck to not attack with them.
That's true. That's how I play. I want to give the beatdowns. So Crockett's got some blocking to do. They'll sort out the power and toughness of all of these creatures. Remember, Council's Lieutenant does not get its own bonus. It's just a 3-2 first striker when it attacks.
Two mana 3-2 first striker that pumps all your other creatures.
That's all it is. That's all it does. Dragon Hunter going to be a 2-2 on this attack. You'll see a 3-2. Some damage is going to be dealt around here. Again, Dragon Hunter protection from dragons. And it can block dragons as though it has reach. So after the dust settles, looks like Emma Handy's board is still very much intact. The follow-up is another copy of Dragon Hunter and a passing of the turn back to Crockett. She'll untap and draw. Picked up a copy of Vile Aggregate. Has a copy of Hedron Crawler in hand. There's also an Eldrazi Displacer in hand as well. Going to start with the Crawler.
And Rebecca has to position herself here to play to some of her bigger outs. Chandra Flamecaller right now, she's a few lands away. She doesn't have it in her hand right now, but if she can hang on long enough and get that on the board, it's going to completely swing the tide of battle.
Now, a little unique little play right there. We saw Rebecca play a Hedron Crawler and then immediately tap it for mana.
Yep.
Because of the old Thopter Engineer.
The Engineer.
Yeah? That's just good deck building right there. Now this is going to make things a little more difficult. That is Athalia's Lieutenant. That means Emma Handy's going to have to go reaching for some dice because the team's going to get a little bit bigger.
Everything's getting bigger here.
You see, when Thalia's Lieutenant enters the battlefield, put a +1/+1 counter on each other human you control. So there are quite a few humans on the battlefield. And when another human enters the battlefield under your control, put a +1/+1 counter on Thalia's Lieutenant. These humans get pretty big pretty fast, Craig.
Yeah, this is one of the payoff cards for playing humans. It looked like Black-Red Vampires was going to be the aggressive deck of this set initially when cards were being spoiled. But they just didn't have the staying power. And we see this board kind of get clogged up, a lot of creatures on it. And when a card like the Lieutenant comes down, it gets out of control fast.
Yeah, this is making this attack even better here for Handy. We saw some chump blocking take place last turn for Crockett. There's going to have to be some more chump blocking that takes place. And this is kind of white's bread and butter, right? You know, you're generally going to win combats like this. You're just scared of wrath effects and just bigger things that dominate the board.
Yep. So Emma was able to trade her one creature for three on Rebecca's side, get in some damage, and still have a very significant board state here.
Crockett's going to fall down to three. Handy at a very comfortable 18. Crockett will draw a card. Looked like she picked up a copy of Thought Not Seer. But Emma's cards are on the table.
Yep.
There's not a lot going on in the hand right now.
Well, Rebecca was able to get that the Lieutenant off the board.
Which is important.
Which is very important.
There's another copy of Pian, Kira, and Alar.
All right, and three creatures out of one card here in Pian and Kira. So maybe she's going to be able to cobble together enough defense.
It'll be an untap here for Handy. Pretty big draw step. She will draw. Picked up a copy of Knight of the White Orchid. That is a human.
It's a human. It's not getting a land this time.
But it will put a plus one counter on Thalia's Lieutenant. Now I'm doing a check of the old deck list here, seeing if Emma has Westvale Abbey. She has one. Because that could be a game winner right now. But the attacking is still going to take place. And I think it should. I still think the attacks are pretty good here.
Yeah, it's getting a little worse for her each turn. But the longer she waits, the worse and worse it gets.
Yeah. So got to keep plugging away. And that's exactly what Emma's going to do. Rebecca's going to have to find some good blockers here.
Yeah, and with Rebecca at three, she doesn't have a lot of leeway in making favorable blocks.
See, because those Thopters, even though there's a lot of them, they're still just 1-1s.
Yep.
So they are certainly on chump blocking duty so that Crockett does not die this turn. So you see both players resolve combat damage.
Yeah,
a lot of things are going to die on Rebecca's side.
Rebecca loses basically everything.
Yep. Emma's so nice to give back that Vile Aggregate. Here. Take your only relevant creature back.
And another Displacer off the top is not going to help this situation. Mm-hmm. Seems to be a wrap.
I think the first game is going to go to Emma Handy here. You're going to see Rebecca going to take a look over things, and now she will concede the game. So Emma Handy is going to win game number one here over Rebecca Crockett. White-blue humans up a game here over red-white Eldrazi. And that means now we get to, for the first time today, take a look at some sideboards, because sideboards are going to look a lot different nowadays. So we're going to start with Rebecca Crockett. She's got two Quarantine Fields, a Lantern Scout, a Foundry of the Councils, two Roast, two Secure the Ways, two Silk Wraps, four Eldrazi Obligator, and a Thought Not Seer. What do we like against this white-blue aggressive humans deck?
A lot of these cards don't line up great against the humans. I would expect to see the Roasts come in, maybe the Silk Wraps as well, but the rest of the cards seem very slanted towards control decks.
Yeah, you see Eldrazi Obligator, a haste threat, something that can kind of win games in the Eldrazi mirrors. Doesn't really line up very well against the deck that's, you know, spitting out 1/2s and 2/3s and stuff like that. Quarantine Field can be okay, but it's pretty expensive.
It's hard for that card to cost more mana.
Yeah, that's very true. On Emma Handy's side, we've got two Gideons, two Archangel Avacyn, a Stasis Snare, two Lantern Scouts, and then a lot of one-ofs here in Westvale Abbey, an Archangel of Tithe, a Declaration in Stone, and an Invasive Surgery. An Eerie Interlude, another copy of Reflective Mage, and then two Counterspells there in a Gate.
Yep. I would definitely expect to see the Archangel Avacyns come in. They're going to give her some defense against Chandra Flamecaller. You know, if she comes out ahead, she could just sit on that 5-mana, have Archangel Avacyn just ready to swoop in and save her.
Now, I'm a little surprised the Archangel Avacyn hanging out in the sideboard for Emma, but I think her build of humans is a lot lower to the ground.
It is. You know, that's probably why she has the land in her sideboard as well.
Yeah.
That might be a package, you know, bring in the expensive cards, another mana source.
This is something that White gets access to. They have a lot of good low-end cards, but a lot of pretty good, like, middle high-end cards, too.
That's one of the most interesting things about the deck building right now, is that there are great beatdown cards, there's great mid-range cards, and there's great high-end cards.
Yeah.
So you really have to be careful with how you build your deck. You need to understand what your deck is trying to do and be able to execute that plan.
Well, we're going to see who can execute their plan in game number two in just a moment. But now we talk about the StarCityGames.com, a weekly sale that is taking place. It's going to end Monday at 10:59 a.m. So if you do want to get 25% off moderately played foils, you see a Johnny Vengeant, which we actually had in our cube draft yesterday.
Yes, we did.
That was a pretty good card. Temple Garden, Cryptic Command, and Terminus, among others. Head over to StarCityGames.com. Check out to see what is available on our weekly sale. Again, this does end Monday at 10:59. And then 11 o'clock on Monday, we'll have a new weekly sale for you.
Babe, not a lot of time left.
No.
Just telling the wife at home, you know?
Ah, Jasmine. Yep. Jasmine, she needs to go to StarCityGames.com.
Just a little prompt, you know? You only have until Monday to get me something nice.
And we know she's watching.
Yes.
So she'll be heading that way. Emma Handy is the name player in this match and someone who's starting to make a name for herself on the SG Tour. She is a member of the Disciples of Bolas, a team based out of the North Carolina area. Alian Trazi, Robert Wright, members of that team as well. She can play any musical instrument in a rock band, has qualified for nationals or better in 7 different card games, and she is a Lady Gaga enthusiast. No top 8s on the resume just yet. She does have a 9th place with Rally on Breakers earlier this year, and she's off to a good start so far this weekend. And I think she's playing a deck that we are going to actually see quite a bit of this weekend in some iteration. These humans decks, they look to be pretty popular.
Yeah, and potent.
Yes, that's the other thing. Again, you mentioned it kind of with deck building. You know, are you gonna be really aggressive? Because you can play like 16 one drops.
Yep.
Or you could be a little bit more mid-rangey, have Archangel, have Gideon, have Archangel of Tithe. I have no clue which way the right way to go is.
Yep, and I think that's what's so fun about the first week of the new format. We're going to get to see which way people are going, and that's going to shape things for weeks to come.
Yeah, especially for next week and for that Invitational in Columbus.
Yep.
So I know a lot of people are watching this tournament. There's a Pro Tour in 2 weeks. There's an Invitational next week, and there are a lot of high-profile tournaments where Standard is the name of the game. And this is going to kind of set the pace for these next couple of weekends. And, again, you know, I think that, again, because there's so many different ways that you can build humans, I think it's going to be a deck for sure.
Yep.
It's just what is the best build of it. And truth be told, one build could be right one weekend, and then for another weekend, a different build could be right. So I think that makes it pretty cool as well, as you're not locked into one build and hoping that it lines up correctly.
Yeah, there's a lot of space, and there's so many good cards right now.
Yeah.
So we're going to see tons of innovation. We've seen certain cards kind of fly under the radar for a while before they've broken into the format. And as Wizards puts more and more good cards into sets, we're going to see more and more of that.
Yeah.
We were talking earlier about a card like Chandra Flamecaller, which initially didn't see a lot of play when it was first released. But we waited a couple of weeks. Someone played the card to great success. I think we saw Jerry T in a four-color deck riding into the top eight.
Yeah, his build of Jeskai Black, Chandra was really good. He kept talking about how good it was from over the course of that weekend.
Yep, and thereafter, we've just seen Chandra everywhere.
As I think we should.
Yes, I agree. But you see how long it took to kind of figure out that that was the right card.
Yeah. Both ladies will take a look at the opening hand here in just a moment. We'll be underway for game number two, but we do appreciate you guys hanging with us through those technical difficulties. We, fingers crossed, should be good to go for the rest of the weekend. Cedric Phillips, Craig Kremple's here in the booth. We've got Nick Miller. He's going to be a busy guy all weekend long over in the sideboard doing your deck techs, picking your feature matches. And, of course, if you do want to join in on the conversation at SCG Live, hashtag SCGBALT, all weekend long. Sounds like a sandwich. I'm getting kind of hungry.
Oh, yeah.
See, that would be bacon, avocado, lettuce, tomato.
Avocado is delicious.
Avocado is great.
Good for you?
It's a healthy fat.
At least
that's what they say. I'm not sold that's actually true, but I'll buy in because it tastes really good.
I mean, it's still a vegetable, right?
It's green, so it's got to be somewhat good for you.
Maybe it's a fruit? I don't know.
I don't know, yeah. Someone on Twitter knows. It seems like it's a vegetable.
Sure.
Isn't it like the fruit rule? Like, if it has a seed, then it's a fruit? I think that's the rule.
I don't know the rules. Right.
But the thing in the middle is not a seed. I don't think it's a seed. It's a pit. But maybe it's a giant seed. I feel really stupid right now. Someone will clear it up for me.
That's it. You know, I've spent most of my adult life trying to avoid fruits and vegetables at all costs.
That's an interesting strategy.
And it's paid off thus far. You know, I'm still here. I'm behind the booth with you.
Thin and trim.
Yeah.
Looking good.
Body by bacon.
Yeah. That's got a nice ring to it.
Yeah.
That's your first sponsorship. I like that. That is very nice. Both ladies here will present each other's decks. We'll be taking a look at some opening hands here. Action will be underway. Keep in mind, 624 players here this weekend in Baltimore, among them Jerry Thompson, Todd Anderson, Brad Nelson, Jim Davis, who is our players champion, defending and reigning. We got Caleb Shearer, our defending invitational champion. Tom the Boss Ross is getting his burn on because he's got a couple of buys. We even have the world champion here this weekend in Seth Manfield. He wants to play some new standard because, hey, he's got a Pro Tour to get ready for in a couple weeks.
Oh, yeah.
No one misses the first weekend, man. It's one of the most fun tournaments to play in.
All right, getting things started here.
Caves of Koilos. Colorless land. White mana for the splash. And there's one of those new Shadowlands, the port town, and now there's Kithian again. This has also been an interesting card to me because one of the things in these white human decks is there's a Hangerback Walker for one for Rebecca, is you have access to so many one drops.
Mm-hmm.
How many Kithians do you want to play? Do you even want to play any Kithians? I think the card's almost too powerful not to play, but it's also legendary, so then you've got that working against you a little bit. You know, we've seen red decks that play four Zergos. Do you want to play four Kithians when you have that many one-drops? Tough to say.
Well, yeah, and, you know, a lot of these decks might top out at the bigger Gideon, and if you're going to have a four-drop Gideon and a one-drop Gideon, these two things don't mesh well.
That's not great deck.
Yeah.
Maybe.
But Emma, we see Emma playing three Kithian.
Okay.
So she's not going to run into the legendary problems too much.
Good.
And she's relegated the two Gideons to her sideboard.
Sure. One of the things that I've heard, because I haven't got to play many games myself getting ready for this show, is a lot of people, they're not a big believer in the four mana Gideon anymore. They said the format's changed quite a bit where it's nowhere near as good as it used to be.
My testing has shown that to be the case.
The card's so good. It's just, I'm willing to believe it because obviously formats change and what's going to be good is dictated by the cards around it, but it's such a good card. To see it be kind of poor now is just a little strange.
Well, another white card has come in and kind of displaced it. Archangel Avison just comes down, flies over the top, and eats it alive.
That's true. I thought you were talking about Eldrazi Displacer, right? See, I was preparing for a pun.
Yeah.
But incorrectly.
That's what I need to do is keep you on your toes.
That's right.
Is there a pun coming?
Nope, not for me.
Is Craig serious?
Yeah.
We can't tell.
Emma does have a land and always watching in hand, so perhaps that'll be the route that she goes. But instead, a Reflector Mage is going to take care of Hangar Backwalker. Not a bad strategy.
Yeah, this is a really good turn for Emma here.
Now here come the attackers and no real good blockers here with the Hedron Crawler. So now, the Lieutenant is going to get a little bit larger.
Yep.
A renowned trigger will occur. So that's what the die represents. And now we're going to be heading back Crockett's way. This was a problem for her in the previous game as well. She just fell behind too quickly.
Yeah, and we'll see if this game, if she can make all of her land drops, top out a Chandra Flamecaller, or get a bigger creature out there sooner, she might be able to hold down the fort. But her hand looks a little sparse right now, and it's looking bad to start things again.
There's a Hedron Crawler now, an Eldrazi Displacer, and a passing of the turn. Keep in mind, for those of you watching at home, four copies of Chandra Flamecaller in Crockett's deck. So there are plenty to draw to.
Sure.
The issue is not playing too few. It's playing as many as she can. So we head back over to Handy.
And Rebecca's about to take a whole bunch of damage again. The Displacer can be good in a lot of games. It can turn off the Lieutenant if she has some time. But she's so far behind already that she might not have the opportunity to do that.
Handy to draw a card. Again, always watching in hand at this stage. That is that brand new Crusade that is very, very powerful.
But we saw how good Reflector Mage was. She had the Crusade in her hand, and it was better to play the Reflector Mage, get another threat on the board, clear the way. Rebecca couldn't even replay the Hangarback Walker, which would have been a great blocker.
It looks like Displacer's going to get in front of Reflector Mage. Now, keep in mind, because the Council's Lieutenant, there's a trigger here. So I believe that Displacer's actually going to lose in combat.
Yeah.
Because Reflector Mage should be a 3-4. And it looks like Crockett may have missed that interaction.
Well, it's possible she's backed into a corner here, mm-hmm. where she needs to make this block and hope that Emma misses the trigger.
Sure. Gideon is going to flip now. Hello. Hello, different Gideon. We'll take a look at the Battleforged.
How do you feel about paying one mana for a Planeswalker?
I'm for it.
Yeah.
And you know I love white creatures.
Yep.
I'm a big fan of them. So to see this card getting a little bit of shine now makes me happy. The 3-bin Spectre is going to bring a clue along with it. But Gideon Battleforged is pretty powerful. We did not see this in the previous standard format. It was not the right time for it, but it might be the right time for this. He saw the plus. It's going to untap that Knight of the White Orchid and put it on defense pretty well here. And then that thing can attack as all Gideons can. Emma's going to dump some cards out there. Another Council's Lieutenant along with that Inspector, the clue on the battlefield. Pass the turn back over to Crockett. Now, you've been playing Magic for a long time, as have I.
A little bit.
This is a bit of a grandiose statement, as Crockett's going to take her turn. This might be one of the times where white's actually the best color in the format.
It's possible. It's tough to say. You know, we are literally two rounds.
We are
into the new format.
We are. The conversation has been that white is very, very good right now.
It is. But as we see the metagame kind of shape up, it's possible we see some of the control decks come out with the right answers, and they're able to suppress some of these more aggressive decks.
Has there ever been a time where white has just been the clear front runner in a format?
Rebels.
Okay. See, that was before me.
Sure.
I was learning how to play competitive Magic then. I've heard some stories about that time.
Yeah, Lin Sivi was...
that was a Magic card?
Just quickly banned.
Yeah.
just, oh, let's make this card. Oh, okay, we shouldn't have made this card.
Error. Error. Big mistake.
Yeah.
Here's a port town. That's an always watching. The creatures are getting bigger yet again. This is how white likes to rock and roll. Look, if this deck's really good, by the way, this Humans deck, looks a little bit like Githkin right now, I might retire the headset. Get back in the field.
This is right in your wheelhouse.
I'm loving everything that's happening right now.
Yeah. We could just change the creature type on the cards?
Yeah. Always watching, very similar to Glorious Anthem. You got some nice one drops. Very similar to Gold Medal Stalwart and Figure of Destiny. I never had Reflector Mage. That just plays itself.
Yeah, seeing how much better the cards have gotten over the years.
And just a smidge.
It's just a little ridiculous.
Just a touch.
Might put the old headset down, pick the sleeves back up.
Yes, those creatures do not tap to attack because of always watching, granting vigilance. Some blocks will take place. Hangarback Walker is going to shoot out some Thopters, but Rebecca is down to one.
And it looks like Emma has missed the trigger on her lieutenant here. It didn't get renowned, but it's probably not going to be a factor in this game.
I don't think it's the end of the world. You obviously want to play as tight as you can in all the matches that you play. A little bit earlier here today, just round number two, as you did mention. Don't think that's a mistake we'll see from Emma in the future.
Yep, not a big deal. She's so far ahead. There's so much on the board. It's easy to just miss a trigger like that.
The follow-up here. That's the old lifelinker ally. Our good friend Lantern Scout from Rebecca Crockett. But not being too aggressive and not going to be able to gain a lot of life.
Yeah, Rebecca's in such a tough spot. You know, she needs to kind of attack the Planeswalker, but she needs her her creatures on defense. No good options.
Nope. Emma, I believe, with another copy of Always Watching Hand, but it looks like she's going to start off with a declaration in stone. I think the Thopper tokens are a good choice. Take care of those. No clues given away. And it looks like Crockett might be conceding the game. We'll see here in just a moment. I think Emma initially said she maybe wanted to target Hedron Crawler. And then said, you know, there are two Thoppers out there I could kill.
Sure, and it's not going to matter either way.
Yeah, I don't think so. You see Emma pointing to the Council's Lieutenant that she missed the Renown trigger on. She realizes her mistake now. So it looks like there's a bit of a judge call taking place here. So we'll try to figure out exactly what's going on. We'll have that communicated to us just as soon as we can. But in the meantime, we can talk about both of these decks here. Again, White Blue Human's a deck that we expect to see a lot of. The splashes are very easy, though. Again, you're playing more of a green-centric build, so I ask you, what green cards come along with the package if you want to be more white-green humans instead of white-blue humans?
Well, I was very low to the ground with my deck.
Okay.
So I was playing Servant of the Scale. I was playing the Avatar. What's the Avatar's name?
Avatar of the Resolute.
Of the Resolute. And then I was playing Nissa to put counters on all of my guys.
Okay.
So if you can go one drop, one drop, one drop, Nissa counters on your guys, turn four, Avatar of the Resolute comes down and gets three or four counters on it, it's a pretty absurd start.
Well, that's what green brings to the table. We see what blue brings to the table in Reflector Mage, and it also brings a win Emma Handy's way. She's going to win this match here over Rebecca Crockett. 2-0. White the Humans does take care of Red-White Eldrazi, and we've done it. We have done it. We have covered a match of Magic.